Psalms 33, verse 18. I'll be reading from the NIV translation of the Bible. It reads, "But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those whose hope is in his unfailing love, to deliver them from death and keep them alive in famine." Let us pray, Father. We've been talking about this one for a while, and this day has come into fruition where it's going to be spoken, and I just ask that you bless your people and that they understand exactly what it means to be blessed by the word of God, to be filled with the word of God. Have your way, Holy Spirit, for it's in Jesus' most precious name I pray. Amen. Because God is creator, Lord, Savior, and deliverer, he is worthy of our trust, worship, and praise. Some believe David wrote this psalm, and David wants his readers to understand that all of God's words, every single one, can be trusted. Every single one of God's words can be trusted. Verse 4 of Psalms 33 tells us the word of God is reliable, unlike people. Unlike people, God's word is reliable. God does not lie. God does not forget, nor does he change his mind. Change his words, because sometimes he will change his mind. Thank God for that. So read verse 4 real quickly from 33 again. It says, "For the word of God is right and true. He is faithful in all he does." God will do exactly what he says in his word. He will not leave one promise unfulfilled. Whatever God has promised you, it will be done. Oh, I'm glad I got a praying church this afternoon. Verse 6 through 9 says we can trust the Bible because it contains the words of a holy, trustworthy, and unchangeable God. Look at what it says in 6 through 9 of 33. It says, "By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, their starry host by the breath of his mouth. He gathers the waters of the sea into jars. He puts the deep into storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the people of the world revere him. For he spoke and it came to be. He commanded and it stood firm." The other day, the Holy Spirit spoke these four words to me. A present day famine. A present day famine. Currently, this nation is going through a tough period, a famine. Gas is high and the price continues to go up. Food prices are climbing. You know, you can go to Winn-Dixie and you're paying Publix prices. You can go to Publix and now you're paying Whole Food prices. So food prices are climbing and many people are struggling to make ends meet. People are losing their homes, and those who want to buy a home have a difficult time qualifying. It seems as though America is in a recession. The politicians are divided on so many issues. Amen? Our country is starving economically and spiritually. But the believers in Christ will be just fine. The wars in other countries are costing U.S. taxpayers billions and billions of dollars. And our leaders in the government are not looking towards God for any help. My brothers and sisters in Christ, we know where our help comes from. We know where our help comes from. Our help comes from the Lord. We know where we need to go to be fed. Have your way, Holy Spirit. I know you're here. The government is telling America not to panic. But people are finding it hard not to panic when a country is divided and the news about the economy and the spiritual state of our country and world is not getting any better. We look around and see businesses that we frequent suddenly are closed. The Walgreens, they're all closing down. Look around. The one that's right here off of Oakland, to your left, if you getting ready to turn off of Oakland onto University. You can see that they're not even redoing the Walgreens sign. It's fading out because it is fading out as well. People are going to work and finding out that their position is being cut out of the budget. It's hard not to panic. Dade County getting ready to go through a massive, massive budget cut. And people are going to be losing their jobs. Many people in our country are starving spiritually. God has stopped speaking to those who don't want to hear a word from him through the word of God, the Bible. God is only speaking to a few people. God is only speaking to a few people. Let me hear you say, God is only speaking to a few people. Have your way, Holy Spirit. And the reason God is only speaking to a few people, because the majority of people are not reading the word of God. Therefore, God is not speaking to many. We began the message reading verse 18 through 20 of Psalms 33, which offers hope to those who believe and revere the Lord, those who trust him in tough times. The word of God is where we go to be fed. Amen? The title of this afternoon's message is A Present Day Famine. A Present Day Famine. The word famine is found 96 times in the Bible. Famine, according to Webster Dictionary, means an acute and general shortage of food or any acute shortage. If it's a shortage of something, it very well can be a famine taking place. Throughout history, the world has experienced many famines. This is not the first, and it won't be the last. But Holy Spirit wants to speak to us about our present day famine. The world's acute shortage of the word from God. 3 points to our message this afternoon. We're done. Number one, God knows the food the believer needs. Secondly, trusting the word is food for the soul. And our last point, the worst famine. God knows, number one, the food the believers need. Verse 18, look at it. Verse 18, the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those whose hope is in his unfailing love. God knows what this nation needs, and above all, he knows what his children need, and he will provide. He says it in his word. Turn to Philippians 4:19. Oh, Holy Spirit, speaking to me now. He says, and my God, Paul says, will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We can trust God will always, don't miss that, always, don't miss that word, not sometimes, always meet all our needs. This is feasting, my brothers and sisters. If you want to feast on the word, you got to get into the word. You got to eat of the word. But if you don't eat, you can't feast. Oh, if you don't eat, you can't feast. All our needs, not some, all our needs. Whatever we actually need on earth, God will always supply. Supply even if, like Paul, the courage to face death. Nobody hardly clapping on that one. Well, Pastor, I don't need the courage to face death. I just believe that I'm going to live to be a long, long, I believe I'm going to live a long life, but you don't know that. We must remember there is a difference between our wants and our needs. God knows we definitely need food, amen? Especially food that feeds us spiritually. And anytime you hear somebody say, that means you hungry. And most of you don't say you're hungry. You say, I'm starving. I'm starving. I need to eat. And you know how you feel when you're starving physically. Many people today don't feel that same way about the word of God. They're starving and they don't care. They're starving and they don't do nothing about their starvation. They're famished and they don't do nothing about that famish. We may not get all we want, but by trusting in Christ, our attitudes and appetites will change from wanting everything to accepting God's provision and power to live and serve him. God will not let us starve. God will not let us starve. God will not let us starve. Hallelujah. Romans 8:35 says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? If God loves you, you know he's not going to let you starve. Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? These words contain one of the most comforting promises in all the scriptures. Believers have always had to face hardships of many kinds. But our God says, what can separate us from his love? Nothing. And he even said, famine? Famine? No, nothing. Demons? Nothing. Persecution? Nothing can separate us from the love of God. God loves us that much that he will provide. You just got to believe it and trust it. These words contain some of the most comforting promises in all scriptures. Believers have always had to face hardships in many forms, famine, illness, and even death. These things could have caused the believers whom Paul was writing to fear that they have been abandoned by Christ. When you don't read your word, you will feel like you've been abandoned by God. You don't have nothing to sustain you. You don't have nothing to give you energy, because when you're starving physically, you lose energy. You feel weak. My wife the other day when she was working, she says, Faye, go get me some lunch. I'm starving. I'm getting weak. And when you don't eat, it's something about your hand. I don't know why your hands start shaking. And you get a little dizzy because your body needs nourishment. Your soul needs nourishment to be strong. But if you're starving your soul, you're going to be weak. Come, you're going to be weak because you have not nourished your very soul. Preach, Holy Spirit, preach. I'm here to tell you there is never a shortage of God's presence and provision for those who put their trust in him. The word of God, Christ says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. But you got to be in your word to receive that. You got to eat. Oh, Holy Spirit, you're so good. I see on TV when they're playing basketball, they are coming on to eat. We better eat the word of God instead of eat the way the world try to tell you to eat. Amen. Paul said that it is impossible to be separated from Christ. This is our assurance that no matter what comes against us, we have Christ. We have the word of God to feed on. Proverbs 10:3, turn there. Proverbs 10:3. The Lord does not let the righteous go hungry. The Lord does not let the righteous go hungry, but he thwarts the craving of the wicked. This verse is intended to communicate the general truth that life of the person who seeks God is better in the long run than the life of the wicked person, a life that leads to ruin. Right there. I found the commentary interesting about this proverb. It assumes that this is a government that cares for the poor, the famished, and the needy, the kind of government Israel was intended to have. But look at Deuteronomy 24, verse 17. This is what God says about the government that they intended to have, Israel. He says right here, Deuteronomy 24, verse 17, do not deprive, talk to the government, the foreigners of the fatherless of justice, or take the cloak of the widow as a pledge. Remember that you your field and you look over and you overlook a sheaf, do not go back to get it. Leave it for the foreigners, the fatherless, and the widows, so that your Lord God may bless you in all the works of your hands. Verse 20, when you beat the olives from your trees, do not go over the branches a second time. Leave what remains for the foreigners, the fatherless, and the widows. When you harvest the grapes in your vineyard, do not go over the vines again. Leave what remains for the foreigners, the fatherless, and the widows. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt. That is why I command you to do this. A corrupt government often ruins the plans of the righteous. We have good intentions, but the government are not seeking God's food. They are not seeking God's word. Therefore, the plans of the righteous, which is to love one another, to forgive one another, to live peaceful with one another, are destroyed by a crooked, wicked government. However, don't miss this. The government where our alliance lies is in the kingdom of God. And God never hinders or ruins the plans of the righteous. My allegiance is not in the United States of America. The United States of America, they benefit because my allegiance is in the kingdom of God. And therefore, I do what is right as far as the kingdom of the United States is concerned. I obey the laws of this country because my Bible, my God tells me to do so. But my allegiance is to an awesome, almighty God, the sovereign God, the God that is God all by himself. Not no president, not no dictators. I don't care whatever else kind of leader in another country claim to be. My God, King of Kings and Lord of Lords is where my allegiance lies. No other God. Jeremiah 29:11 says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. I don't see that in the United States right now. All I see is division. My Bible says, the word of God says, a house divided will fall. But the kingdom of God is not divided. Holy Spirit always takes the position to encourage us to move ahead. He knows we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. There is plenty of strength in Christ Jesus. There is no famine in Christ. There's no weakness in Christ. Even when we are weak, the Bible says that is when we are strong, because of the Lord is our strength. There's no famine in Christ. Let me hear you say, there's no famine in Christ. God knows the future, and his plans for us are good and full of hope. The word of God says that Christ came to give us life and the life of abundance. No government, no president, no demons, nothing can stop what God has for us. If God be for us, if God be for us, if God be for us, this brings us to our second point. Our second point is trusting the word of God is food for the soul. Look at holy name. Look at verse 22 along with that. Just may your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. Psalms 9:10 says, those who know your name trust in you, for you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. God will never forsake those who seek him. He says, I will never abandon those who truly put their trust in me. You got to be for real. Can't be faking it till you make it. New Ark Covenant Church, we constantly reach out to the Lord and trust him. This is why we are well fed. There's no famine here. We trust what the word of God says. Our souls are satisfied. I'm satisfied. I'm feeling good because I'm well fed. We have reached the Lord through the word of God. We have reached God through prayer. And we also have reached assembly. I heard Holy Spirit when he was preaching and teaching and praying through Elder Ephraim when he said, how many of you last Sunday woke up and said, I can't wait to get into church next Sunday? My brothers and sisters, because we are eating from the word of God, because we pray and because we constantly come to church to be fed, we are not famished. We're not starving. Our God tells us that we will never starve, no matter what we are going through, because we have the word of God to speak to us about life and how God will sustain us. Oh, Lord, have your way. Holy Spirit. My soul is satisfied. My God sustains us. There's no shortage of help from God. There is a present day famine taking place, but we will not be fazed, but we will be fed. We will hear from God, unlike so many. There's no famine of the word of God of those who pick up their Bibles and read it. Psalm 62:8 says, trust in him at all times. You people, pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge. The word of God, y'all keep hearing the word of God. The word of God is food for the soul. It says, he is our safe house, a shelter from danger or trouble. There's plenty of room in him. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. There's plenty of room in him. There's no acute shortage of refuge in Christ, who is our strong and high tower. There's no acute shortage of the power of the Lord Jesus Christ for those who eat from the word of God. You know why I'm powerful? Because I eat. Not Wheaties. The breakfast of champions, I eat from the word of God. This is the food for champions, right here. You can eat all the Wheaties you want, but it ain't gonna make you as strong as you need to be in times of famine in this world. Jesus Christ is the accommodation for those who trust him. He will shield us from the terrible storms of life. There is plenty of shelter, plenty of shelter in the kingdom of God. Good and not only is it good, it's plenty of it. Some people like to starve. I don't know why. We are not famished. The word of God says we have a place to go for shelter and eat. God provides plenty of protection for those who trust him for protection against the famine of the world, a famine of no hope. Trusting God, there's a lot of people are getting really, really upset and afraid that we're going to have a civil war. My God is in control. I have hope. We are filled. I heard Elder Ephraim pray about filledness, being filled. We are filled with God's strength. Nothing can shake us. Nothing can shake us. If you're saying amen, believe it. We are filled, which means we are not famished. We are not lacking strength. But the worst famine, our last point, the worst famine that man can experience is the acute shortage of God's word. When God stops speaking to you, you will die from spiritual starvation. There's going to come a time when we ain't going to have no word. They're going to take the Bibles from us. Mm-hmm. And if you got a Bible, you might go to jail. But you better have enough in you. You better have enough in you. That, you know, I believe, you know, Holy Spirit showed me this. I believe I'm correct in saying this. I think a camel, they in the desert, they eat so much food that they can store it. I know a bear does too, because when he hibernates, he can bring back up that food. I don't know what he does. I don't know if he bring it back up. I never got into the wild kingdom or all that other good stuff about animals. But one thing I do know, in school, they told me the bear hibernate, collects all that food. I don't know if he eats it or he stores it and he eats rotten food. I don't know. But one thing I do know, they got enough in them to sustain them. And I'm here to tell you, my brothers and sisters, you better get enough word in you, because there's going to come a time where you're going to need it to sustain you. It's getting serious. I have to rely on the word every time I see the news. God tell me, I am sovereign. I am King of kings and Lord of lords. The prayers of a righteous man availeth much. My Bible says, although I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. I got word in me. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I got word in me. Holy Spirit is so funny. He gave me a joke. Hump day. But anyway, that was just for me. I got word in me. I got word in me. I will withhold no good thing from those who. Morning. I got word in me. The joy of the Lord is my strength. I eat every day. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Turn to Amos chapter 8, verse 11. Holy shit, some of them don't even know where Amos is. Some of them didn't even know it was an Amos in the Bible. Amos chapter 8, verse 11. The days are coming, declares the sovereign Lord, when I will send a famine through the land, not a famine of food or a thirst for water, but a famine of hearing the words of the Lord. People will stagger from sea to sea and wander from north to east, searching for the word of the Lord, but they will not find it. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things shall be added unto you. I got word in me. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that comes to God must believe that he is who he says he is, and he will reward those who what? Diligently seek him. That means seek the word. People don't seek the word like that no more. They just depend on Sunday from Sunday to Sunday. But I need it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. How many of you going to eat today and wait until next Sunday to eat a physical food? You can't wait to get out of here now to go get you some Kentucky fried or some black beans and rice or some ribs or hamburger or hoagie. What kind of food? What'd you say? What'd you say? Yeah, French fries. Yeah, I know. It's right down the street. Pull in there and get me a medium fry and a Coke. We got a long day ahead of us. I told her you need to eat tonight, last night. It's a long day ahead of us tomorrow because I know my wife, she won't eat in the morning. She won't eat in the afternoon until after church. So you got to eat. A long day I got her. And yesterday she said, I'm going to get me a fry at the church. In Amos chapter 8, 11 through 13, the people who are spoken about in this verse had no appetite for God's word when the prophets like Amos spoke it. Because of their lack of interest, God said he will withhold the word from them. If you got a lack of interest in the word, guess what? He gonna stop speaking to you. We have God's words, but many still look for answers of life problems everywhere except from scriptures. People in our country and this world are suffering from the worst famine. They are starving themselves because they choose not to feast from God's table. David says he prepares a table before my enemies. My cup runs over. That is feasting, my friends. He could have said he prepares a table filled to the top of my plate before my enemies, and my cup, and he said, and my cup runs over. He ain't gonna just let the cup run over. The table was filled with food. He prepares my table. Not the food that you would eat in the natural, but the food that you need to eat in the spiritual. Have your way, Holy Spirit. That's what I'm talking about. Feast or famine, which do you prefer? To feast or experience famine? In the time of Eli, the high priest, few prophets were speaking God's message to Israel. Just a few. Because Eli's sons were evil and refused to listen to God, this caused God to stop communicating with Israel. in this present day, the world is very wicked, and the people refuse to listen to God because they refuse to read his word. God is silent. My brothers and sisters, listening and responding is vital when you have a relationship with God. Although God does not always use the sound of a human voice, he always speaks clearly through his word. When we receive a word from God, we must be ready to act on what he tells us. If you don't read the word, you can't hear what he wants you to hear. You will starve to death. Feast. And the word was God. Verse 14 of that same chapter, John 1 says, the word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. The word of God says, Christ is the bread of life. John 6:35, Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. The word of God also says in Matthew 6:11, give us this day our daily bread. That daily bread is the word of God. The word sustains us while others will starve because they don't eat this daily bread, which came from heaven like God provided manna to the Israelites in the wilderness. Daily. And anything they tried to store up for later, we are not famished. The word sustains us while others will starve because they don't eat this daily bread, which has came from heaven. But New Ark Covenant Church, we eat this daily bread, and this is why we are okay. We are not famished, but we are full and satisfied. This is the day that the Lord has made, right here. This day, I will rejoice and be glad in it because I'm eating the word. We eat this bread because we are not self-sufficient. We trust God daily to provide what he knows we need. If you're starving spiritually, that's your fault. Because he says, I have provided, I have supplied you with everything you need. Food to sustain you through this life. Don't be starving, my brothers and sisters. Eat up. There's plenty at the table for everyone to eat. Let us pray. Your word is not only food for the soul, but a lamp upon our feet. Your word is powerful, and it is as sharp as a double-edged sword, able to even cut the marrow in the bone, even so sharp that it can cut the dust that may be on our floors, on our shelves. So, Father, I pray that we continue to eat because you said your word satisfies. You said your word will strengthen us. Let us eat that bread of life. Let us not grow weary in well-doing, for in due season we'll reap a harvest if we don't give up. Let us continue to keep that word in us, like the animals that store up in them the food to sustain them through a period of time. There is going to come a time where we're going to need word in us. There are going to be times when situations, persecution, trials are going to come our way. Testing is going to come up. We're going to need word in us to sustain us, to get us through it. I ask that you have mercy upon our souls, Lord. So with that being said, as we give our benediction, I'm going to ask, Holy Spirit said, for the church to stand. The church to stand. Everyone standing. And repeat after me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespassers as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, for thine is the power, for thine is the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you, Father. Now, as we depart from this place, continue to place your hedge of protection around us, and let us not just be satisfied with the food we just received, but let us continue to eat of your word. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you all.
I want to know you. I want to know you. I want to know you for who you really are. I want to know you. I want to know you. I want to know you. Can we say that?